Tonight we have a real treat. Sarah Boswell is speaking. Sarah is one of our student pastors. She heads up the student ministry with her husband, Jamie. They got married last year. And it's just a real privilege to introduce Sarah. She's great. And yeah, it's just a joy to have her speak with us at the Seven. So let's welcome Sarah Boswell.
Wonderful. Good evening, everyone. I hope you're all doing wonderfully well. As Stephen said, my name is Sarah, and married to Jamie. We got married actually earlier on this year in February. And about 4 months after we got married, we had been on a weekend away, and the first 4 months had been pretty hectic of our marriage. And you know, when life gets pretty hectic, the first thing to go, or for us anyway, first thing to go is cleaning the house. Everything gets an absolute state. So we got to the point, and boxes hadn't been kind of unpacked because we'd just moved into the house, and plates were piled high in the kitchen, and everything was in an absolute mess. And my parents were arriving the next day for the very first time to see our new house. And we arrived back at about 11 in the evening, and we said, okay, let's just do a quick clean of the house, make sure everything's kind of okay. We want to make it look nice when the parents come. And then we'll go to bed and then get up. They come first thing tomorrow. And you know when a 20-minute job turns into like a 20-hour job, it takes way longer than you expect it to. Jamie and I are both all or nothing people, and this was definitely an all task. So I decided to conquer upstairs. He was going to conquer downstairs. And so I went upstairs and I cleaned everything that you could possibly clean and tidy, and was alphabetizing things and, you know, folding up things that probably didn't need to be folded up because Mum would never look in that drawer, or various different things. Went to the absolute extreme. And about kind of early hours of the morning, I heard this little whimpering from downstairs, a kind of a Sarah. And I was like, what's that? Assuming that Jamie obviously was doing the same downstairs, cleaning up, making sure everything was fine. And made my way downstairs and found that he'd taken it upon himself to actually start rewiring some of the electrics in a downstairs cupboard. Who knows why? Men will be men, I suppose. Went downstairs, and it was a cupboard that had loads of stuff in it. There was loads of boxes, all sorts of junk in there. And so he had taken everything out of the cupboard, and it was in the corridor everywhere. And he was stuck inside the cupboard rewiring this thing, and had obviously got a bit hot and flustered. So I came down, finding him only wearing his boxer shorts and a headlamp. Who knows why? And, you know, his problem is he couldn't stay stuck to the task at hand. He got completely distracted by rewiring the electrics in our downstairs cupboard. I've no idea why. But actually got completely distracted from what was right in front of him, was the task at hand, which was cleaning the downstairs. So we had a very, very late night that night. But that's what I want to talk to us about today, is how so often we can miss what is right in front of our noses because we get distracted. We get distracted so easily. And I want to talk from the story of Nehemiah. Now, the kind of story of Nehemiah, the book in the Bible, it begins with this guy, Nehemiah, and his brother coming to visit. And his brother says, Nehemiah, the walls of Jerusalem have been completely destroyed. The city has been burned and the walls have been knocked down and the city's in an absolute state. And to understand the importance of this, we need to see Jerusalem was an incredibly significant city at the time to the Jews. For hundreds of years, God had promised to the Jews that he would find them a home, that he would take them to a land that they could call theirs, that he would dwell with them forever in this place that he had brought them to. In Psalm 132, verse 14, God is saying of Jerusalem, this is my resting place forever and ever. Here I will sit enthroned, for I have desired it. Jerusalem represented God's promise to his people. God's promise that he would dwell with them forever, that he would be with them, that he was for them, represented his promise to his people. But the Babylonians had come, they'd invaded Jerusalem, they'd burnt everything up. And therefore, understandably, Nehemiah was devastated by this news. And it says in chapter 1, it says he sat down and wept and mourned for days. Mourned for days. It was a significant place for them. And it was completely destroyed and obviously really, really shook Nehemiah. And so he decided to take it upon himself to go to Jerusalem, recruit a team and rebuild the walls. Now, I'm sure that is no small task, rebuilding the walls of a city. I've never done it myself, but I'm imagining it is an incredibly complex task, having loads of admin to do. I'm sure there wasn't Excel in the time of Nehemiah, but you know, it made sure that he had to have as much organization as he possibly could to get this wall built, because he couldn't do it by himself. And we see in chapter 3, we see a list of various different people that built different parts of the wall. So it said, you know, the son of this person built this part, and the daughter of this person built this part, and this man built this part. Goes through the list of everything. And I want to focus today on one particular verse. It's a very small verse in Nehemiah, but it has really challenged me. And it's verse 28 of chapter 3, and it says, "Above the horse gate, the priest made repairs, each in front of his own house." Priest made repairs, each in front of his own house. Now with Nehemiah, we see a man wanting to rebuild a city that God can dwell in. And I think looking at the story of this, looking at the story of Nehemiah building the walls of this city, is actually a glimpse to the bigger story we are part of. You know, God in the beginning of time, he was longing to dwell with his people. That's been his heart right from the very start, is to be with us, to dwell with his people. And you know, that is exactly why Jesus came. That is exactly why he came to earth. God himself came to earth to dwell with his people, and through his death and resurrection, he made it available for all people at all times to be able to access the presence of God. But the story doesn't end there. We are part of this big story of God coming to earth and building his kingdom. What's his kingdom? It means on earth, the active and transforming presence of God. Everything that we know of God, the goodness of God, the love of God, the peace of God, everything that we know about God being active and at work here on this earth. And that is what he's wanting to build. But the best part is, he wants us to join in this story. He wants us to join in the building project. That we're not here building a wall like Nehemiah was building, but we're here building his kingdom. We're building a place where he can dwell, where he can be. We can make him known to this earth. And so, back to Nehemiah, he's building a wall, and we can learn from this. And I don't know if you've ever tried to build a wall. I definitely haven't. I think it would be an absolute disaster if I did. But often when I get put to a task, I get so easily distracted. I don't know if you're the same. And I can be working just on the computer, and then one thing will pop up, and I'll start kind of looking at that. And then before I know it, I'm looking at kind of random YouTube videos about tigers or something ridiculous. I get so distracted so easily. And for me at the moment, one of the big things that I get distracted by is my phone. Jamie and I have had broken phones, smashed screens, they vibrate randomly, they can't add contacts. Everything that could go wrong with a phone went wrong with our phones. So at Christmas, we got new phones, which was like, amazing, great, I can actually see what someone has texted me rather than trying to figure it out. Wonderful, but it is a huge distraction to me because now I'm just on my phone all the time. And I don't know if you've ever tried texting whilst walking. Not a good idea. I am one of the most clumsy people you will ever meet. I always have bruises on me, just from bumping into stuff anyway. But if I am distracted from actually looking where I'm walking, it is a nightmare. Fall downstairs, I bump into people, all sorts of drama. But not quite as dramatic as this man.
Walkway. Mark Kondo in Sky 5. This is very interesting. Apparently the Bears decided to move around.
Oh, garbage cans are out too.
A couple of minutes ago, the Bear left the clearing in the backyard there, and he made his way over to the driveway over on Mayfield. He came down that driveway, down Mayfield, and now he's on Briggs, and now it looks like he's turning into another driveway here. We're going to kind of maneuver around and see if we can get another shot of him.
We
got someone, a resident there.
Just saw the Bear. Oh.
It seems impossible to me that someone could not notice a bear walking down the road. But we get so distracted, don't we? We actually miss what is right in front of us. And I think so often when we're talking about what God is using using us for and things that he's doing in our lives and the way that he's wanting us to join in the building of his kingdom, making him known to this world, we so often get distracted by various different things. I think firstly, we get distracted by looking at what other people are doing, don't we? We get distracted by what's happening in someone else's life or the stories they've got or the way that God is working in their life, and you just think, oh my gosh, that doesn't look like mine. That looks completely different to mine. And I think there's such a privilege being part of a church like HTB where we get to hear some incredible stories from visiting speakers, don't we? Of people that have written loads of books or have kind of gone to prison because they've like stood up for their faith or various different things that are incredibly inspiring. And we walk away from those talks often feeling incredibly inspired. But if I'm really honest, there's a part of me that often feels like I'm failing, that thinks, my life doesn't actually look like that. You know, I'm nowhere near getting put in prison, I hope. Or I'm nowhere near writing loads of books. I can hardly write a letter. You know, I'm nowhere near that. I'm failing. Or we think that actually we're in some sort of timeline. That, you know, this person, I don't know, got some Nobel Peace Prize for doing something amazing in social justice by the time they were 30. And I'm like, I'm only 25. I'm behind on the timeline. I'm not going to get there by the time I'm 30. I couldn't do anything like that. Or, you know, this person met the president for all the great work that they were doing by the time that they were this age. And I'm like, I'm behind. I'm definitely behind. And we get stuck by comparing ourselves to other people, thinking, oh, I'm not as good as them. Or God's not working like that in my life. Or, you know, what I've got, that's nowhere near as impressive as other people. We get so caught up with what God is doing in other people's lives, we actually miss what God is doing in our own lives. You know that verse, it says, and the priest made repairs in the wall in front of their house. They built what was directly in front of them. They didn't get caught up looking at what other people were building. They didn't think, oh, that person's building in a really, really impressive way. I'm just going to look at that for ages. They didn't get kind of jealous about various different parts of the wall that were being built that kind of looked a bit better than theirs. They just got on and built what was in front of them. And I think that's a challenge to us, isn't it? Of actually so often we compare our stories, we miss what God is doing right in front of us. And we so often struggle to live in the present. We compare ourselves, but also we struggle to live in the present. I was at Hampton Court the other day, and there was this incredible sunset. And I love sunsets, and this was a really beautiful one in particular. And I got so caught up trying to take a photo of this sunset, and I was changing all the settings on my camera and trying to get it just right and make it amazing. And I was like, what am I doing? Why am I just sitting here enjoying this sunset? Photos never as good anyway. Why am I just sitting enjoying this sunset? And I realized I so struggle sometimes to live in the present and actually just be content with what is. And I think about 10 steps ahead of myself. I'm always kind of dreaming about what's next, what's the next thing, what am I doing, or where do I want to be, or kind of thinking various different ideas about what I want to do. And actually, I miss what is in right in front of me. And you know, 2014 for Jamie and I was the hardest year of our life. Marriage was brilliant, but straight after our honeymoon, we got back and within hours of landing, found out that Jamie's dad had cancer and about 4 months later passed away. And it was at a point there where we kept thinking, okay, it was a horrendous situation. No one had ever expected that to happen. And during engagement, everyone was like, you know, when you're married, you know, you just got to get through engagement. And when you're married, it's going to be great. And the marriage was brilliant. But actually, you know, the surrounding circumstances were really, really hard. And then we kind of got kind of past a few months. And we were like, okay, well, let's just look forward to September. Things kind of kick off again in September. We were going to start working together. We thought, oh, this would be great. And then Jamie got pneumonia. And then we were like, oh, Christmas. Christmas is the thing. Christmas is the next thing. And then he got ill again and had to have an operation. And it was one thing after another after another. And so often, I think, we look forward to what the next thing is going to be, don't we? We think, oh, the situation right now, that's quite hard. But, you know, when this happens, then it will be better. And God really challenged us, actually, at the time of being like, stop wasting away the moment of now, even if it's hard. Stop wasting away the moment of now. Just to put all your hopes into the next season of what is. Look at what I'm doing now. And I got really challenged of thinking, you know, but I don't have the capacity to be able to do anything now. And I don't have kind of the energy to be able to do stuff. And I can't do this, I can't do that, various different things. And God said, no, 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 let me use the little that you've got right now. Because there is always something good that what God is wanting to do in each moment, even if life is hard and even in moments where it would seem really dark and seem really hopeless. God being like, but look at what I'm wanting to do here now, because he is good. Even when situations are hard, even when situations are rubbish, God is always good and therefore is always wanting to do something that is good. And it's so easy to think that, isn't it? When X happens, then God can start using me. And I don't know what it is for you. It may be, you know, oh, when I'm married, then everything will be fine. It may be when I'm retired, I have a bit more time, I won't be working, God can use me in amazing ways. Maybe, you know, when I leave home, when I have a new job, and it's a bit less stressful, when I have more money, when I have a house, you know, when I have a bigger house, when I have, it goes on and on and on and on. There's always something, isn't there, that we can be waiting for and looking forward to and thinking, oh, God can only use me when, dot, dot, dot. Or we say, if only. And we say, if only I was married. If only I was single. I don't wish I was single, by the way. But, you know, what is it that you go, if only I was working for a church, then it'd be great. God could use me in incredible ways. I'd be able to make him known all over the place. And then the people working in the church say, if only I wasn't working for a church. You know, there's always something, isn't there, that we say, if only. And we actually struggle to see what is right in front of our noses. We get so distracted by where we think is a better place to be and actually struggle to see what God is doing right in front of us and invites us to join in to that. And sometimes we get so overwhelmed, don't we? We are like kind of those builders that look at the wall as a whole and go, oh my gosh, how am I going to build that? And for us saying, you know, whole of London, the whole of the world, there's so much that needs to happen. There's so much that needs to change. God needs to break in so many ways. And it's just such a big task. I can't even possibly begin to tackle it. And we bury our heads and we say, no, I wouldn't make a difference. Who am I to make a difference in something that big? And, you know, I love the fact that in this verse, it says the priests made repairs each in front of their own house. Why the priests? You wouldn't expect them to be builders, would you? Really simply, you just wouldn't expect a priest to be builder. If I had to have an extension built on an imaginary house that I have, if I had to have an extension built, probably the first person I wouldn't ask is Nicky Gumbel. I probably just wouldn't, because he may be an expert builder, but actually his skills probably lie better elsewhere. I wouldn't ask him, because actually, you know, it just doesn't quite make sense. Unlikely character, but in the Bible here it talks about the priests made repairs each in front of their own house. The unlikely characters got their hands dirty. They got involved. And so often we can disqualify ourselves, can't we? Because we say, oh, well, you know, who am I to be able to make a difference anywhere? We each have the same spirit that raised Jesus from the dead living in us. We each have the same spirit that raised Jesus from the dead living in us. Therefore, we can transform the world around us by his spirit. It's not based on who we are. It's not based on how little we think we can bring. It's based on the fact that God chooses to use us through his spirit. And that's partly why I love the vision here at HCB. It's to play our part in the re-evangelization of the nation and the transformation of society. Ultimately, it's a big and exciting project, but we all have a part to play. We can play our part. What does that look like for you? What does your little section of the wall look like? We all have it, and it's only if everyone builds their section of the wall that the whole wall is going to be built. And equally, here, for all of us, we have a part to play in God bringing his kingdom to this earth. We all have a part to play. We are all needed. So what's the wall in front of your house? You know, God is at work. He is doing things in your life already. He's doing things in your life already, and he wants you to join in. He wants you to be part of what he's doing, because he's a father that loves to be with us. He wants us to be part of what he's doing already. And so often when we're talking about kind of making him known or showing him to people or seeing God move in different kind of areas and people that we come into contact with, we often think, oh, we need to do more, you know. Oh, maybe I should set something up. Maybe I should set up a charity where I am. Or maybe I should add this extra little thing into my life. Or maybe I should do this or do that or do something different or move somewhere else. Or, and the list goes on. And actually, God is saying, no, 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 be free of that. Don't feel like you have to add extra things into your life. What I want to do is give you eyes to see what is in front of you. Eyes to see what I'm already doing. You don't need to look elsewhere. You don't need to add other things. I want you to see what I'm already doing right around you. Because that's your part. That's your part of building the wall. And never, ever underestimate what God can do with what you're facing right now. Never underestimate with God, what God can do with what you're facing right now. And when I was a student, a friend of mine, he was meeting up with kind of various different of his mates in his halls and started to have some really good conversations with them. And so decided that they should probably do Alpha. It was a really great tool for them to kind of ask the questions and a platform for just having good discussion. And he was quite kind of not quite knowing what to do. He's a student, he was living in halls, he didn't have his own place, he didn't have much money, he didn't even have a proper space to be able to do it. You know, he didn't really have much. But what he did was he was like, well, I'll just use what I've got. So he got his halls, kitchen, asked people in his halls, said, can I kind of run a bit of a dinner alpha here? And they were like, yeah, yeah, that's fine. Set up an ironing board and a laptop, because he didn't really have anything else. Put in some pizzas in the oven from Tesco, and that was his alpha course. And it got nicknamed Ironing Board Alpha. And one thing I love about that is he used what he had. He didn't wait and go, oh, you know, well, what about next year when I move out into a house? I'll have like my own place then. Or what if I had a bit more money? I'll just wait until I get a job and then I can actually host something really nice and really good and whatever. He says, well, I'll just use what I've got. What's right in front of me. It was that simple. And I remember being really challenged once somebody said to me, they said, I don't have much, but what I do have, I'll give it away. And I love that. I don't have much, but what I do have, I'll give it away. And when we feel either practically we don't have much, or emotionally, or spiritually, whatever it is that we feel like we don't have a massive capacity to be able to bless people with necessarily, saying, actually, the little bit I do have, even if I'm really tired and even if I don't have much time or even if I feel really maxed out emotionally because stuff's been really hard, the little bit I have, that is what I'm going to give to God, and he will multiply that. And trusting that he will do that. We so often have one foot out the door. We so often say, okay, what's next? Moving on to what's next. I'll look at what's next. And I believe God is wanting to say, no, I want you to thrive in this season you're in. I don't want you to wait till the next season happens. I want you to thrive in the season you're in because I've got good things for now. You know, Nikki tweeted a while ago, he said, do what you can with what you have right where you are. And I think that's it, isn't it? It's doing what you can with what you have right where you are. What is in front of you? Going back to that verse, each of the priests built the wall that was right in front of their houses. What is right in front of you? What is right in front of your life right now? What has God placed, or who has God placed in your life? You know, we're talking about Alpha. Alpha is an incredible opportunity to introduce people to Jesus. Really simple. Who has God put in your life right now that you can invite to Alpha? Is it a colleague at work that's actually just having a really hard time at the moment? And you say, actually, you know what? I want to invest a little bit more into that friendship. I'm going to invite them to Alpha because they need to know Jesus. Is it, we say, a family member? You know, a mom, a dad, a grandparent, a grandkid, whoever it is, niece, nephew, that we've just kind of got used to not really knowing God, not quite understanding at all. We've just kind of got used to that. And we're like, actually, that is right in front of me. Family has been right in front of me, and actually, why don't I just ask them to Alpha? The worst they can say is no. It may be someone in your gym class. It may be someone that you bump into. It may be your neighbour. We've been really challenged recently about reaching out to our neighbours and just getting to know them. They're right in front of us. We bump into them as we go out the door. Who has God put right in front of you? And it may be that you're here today and this is your first time to church and first time kind of encountering this stuff of Jesus. And, you know, when we're talking about what is right in front of you, this might be it, coming to church, being like, okay, loads of people really believe in Jesus. What do I think about that? That is right in front of you, and I definitely would encourage you, come along to Alpha and find out more. We so often compare ourselves, get distracted looking at what other people are doing. We make excuses of saying, oh, if only this happened, if only I was like this. Or we become overwhelmed by the bigness of the task at hand and say, my part doesn't matter. What is the wall in front of your house? What is right in front of you? What is God doing already? Because he wants to give you his spirit to be able to join in. Let's pray. Holy Spirit, we thank you that you are the one that empowers us to do anything, that we just have to say yes. And God, we ask that you would give us all eyes to see what you've put in front of us. God, what is the wall that you've put in front of our house that you are asking us to build? Which part of your kingdom do we play our part in building? God, would you help us take our eyes off distractions, things that catch our attention, and help us see what you are doing right in front of our noses? And would you give us your spirit to join in and see the different areas and different people that we come into contact with transformed by your power? In Jesus' name, amen.